sure to hop on over to the Spiritual Broadcast Network. It's the go-to place for all things spiritual. You'll discover internet television shows that you won't find anywhere else. You can also choose from hundreds of hours of spiritual documentaries and movies. You'll enjoy on-demand and live internet television programming 24/7. Best of all, we add new dramas, comedies, talk, and reality shows, and more on a daily basis. So why spend countless hours searching the web when you can quickly find just what you want on the Spiritual Broadcast Network?
Wisdom Through Action is a contemporary, sea-influenced school teaching the work of personal inner development in the system brought to the Western world by G.I. Gurdjieff and P.D. Ouspensky. Mr. Ouspensky said, "The most important ideas and principles of this system do not belong to me. This is chiefly what makes them valuable, because if they belonged to me, they would be like all other theories invented by ordinary minds." What he meant was that this system comes from higher mind, from conscious influence. It is an objective system to bring a man to awakening.
Welcome to Wisdom Through Action, bringing esoteric work into your life. My name is Kay Smith, and I'm your host here along with Cal Gorham. Today's show, we are going to be talking to you about some of the different lines of work, including influences and attitudes that are acting upon you and your soul. And I'm going to begin with a short reading from one of Ouspensky's books, The Fourth Way. A man has to study himself. When I was told that, I saw at once that we do not have any methods of studying ourselves and already have many wrong ideas about ourselves. So I realized that we must get rid of the wrong ideas about ourselves and at the same time find methods for studying ourselves. Perhaps you realize how difficult it is to define what is meant by psychology. There are so many meanings attached to the same words in different systems that it is difficult to have a general definition. So we begin by defining psychology as study of oneself. You have to learn certain methods and principles. And according to these methods and principles, using these methods, you will try to see yourselves from a new point of view. If we begin to study ourselves, we first of all come up against one word, which we use more than any other, and that is the word I. We say, I am doing, I am sitting, I feel, I like, I dislike, and so on. This is our chief illusion. For the principal mistake we make about ourselves is that we consider ourselves one. We always speak about ourselves as I, and we suppose that we refer to the same thing all the time, when in reality, we are divided into hundreds and hundreds of different I's. At one moment when I say I, one part of me is speaking, and at another moment when I say I, it is quite a different part. We do not know that we have one I, but many different I's, connected with our feelings and desires, and have no controlling I. These I's change all the time. One suppresses another, one replaces another, and all this struggle makes up our life. I's which we see in ourselves are divided into several groups. Some of these I's are legitimate, and some they belong to right divisions of man, and some of them are quite artificial and are created by insufficient knowledge and by certain imaginary ideas that man has about himself. To begin self-study, it is necessary to study methods of self-observation, but that again must be based on a certain understanding of the division of our functions. Our ordinary idea of these divisions is quite wrong. We know the difference between intellectual and emotional functions. For instance, when we discuss things, think about them, compare them, invent explanations, or find real explanations, this is all intellectual work, whereas love, hate, fear, suspicion, and so on are emotional. But very often, when trying to observe ourselves, we mix even intellectual and emotional functions when we really feel. We call it thinking. And when we think, we call it feeling. But in the course of study, we shall learn in what way they differ. For instance, there's an enormous difference in speed, but we shall speak more about that later. Then there are two other functions which no system of ordinary psychology divides and understands in the right way: instinctive function and moving function. Instinctive refers to the inner work of the organism, digestion of food, beating of the heart, breathing. These are instinctive functions. To instinctive function belong also ordinary senses, sight, hearing, smell, taste, touch, the feeling of cold and warmth, things like that. And this is all, really. Of outer movements, only simple reflexes belong to instinctive function, because more complicated reflexes belong to moving function. It is very easy to distinguish between instinctive and moving functions. We do not have to learn anything that belongs to instinctive function. We are born with the capacity to use all the instinctive functions. Moving function, on the other hand, all have to be learned. A child learns to walk, to write, and so on. There's a very great difference between the two functions, since there is nothing inherent in moving functions, and instinctive function is all inherent. So in self-observation, it is necessary, first of all, to divide these four functions and to classify at once everything that you observe, saying this is intellectual function, or this is emotional function, and so on. If you practice this self-observation for some time, you may notice some strange things. For instance, you will find that it is really difficult. What is really difficult in observing is that you forget about it. You start to observe, and your emotions connect with some kind of thought, and you forget about self-observation. Again, after some time, if you continue this effort to observe, which is a new function, not used in the same way in ordinary life, you will notice another interesting thing, that generally you do not remember yourself. If you could be aware of yourself at all the time, you would be able to observe all the time, or in any case, as long as you liked. But because you cannot remember yourself, you cannot concentrate. And this is why you will have to admit that you have no will. If you could remember yourself, you could have will and you could do what you liked. But you cannot remember yourself. You cannot be aware of yourself, and so you have no will. You may sometimes have will for a short time, but it turns to something else and you forget about it. This is the situation, the state of our being, the state from which we have to start self-study. But very soon, if you continue, you will come to the conclusion that almost everything from the very beginning of self-study, you have to correct certain things in yourself which are not right, to arrange certain things which are not in their right places. And the system has an explanation for this. We are made in such a way that we can live in four states of consciousness, but such as we are, we only use two. One when we are asleep, and the other when we are what we call awake, that is to say, in this present state, when we can talk, listen, read, write, and so on. But these are only two out of four possible states. The third state of consciousness is very strange. If people explain to us what the third state of consciousness is, we begin to think that we have it. The third state can be called self-consciousness, and most people, if asked, say certainly we are conscious. A sufficient time or repeated and frequent efforts of self-observation is necessary before we fully recognize the fact that we are not conscious, that we are conscious only potentially. If we are asked, we say, yes, I am, and for that moment we are, but the next moment we cease to remember and are not conscious. So in the process of self-observation, we realize that we are not in the third state of consciousness, that we live in only two. We live either in sleep or in waking state, which in the system is called relative consciousness. The fourth state, which is called objective consciousness, is inaccessible to us because it can be reached through self-consciousness, that is, by becoming aware of oneself first, so that much later we may manage to reach the objective state of consciousness. So at the same time as self-observing, we try to be aware of ourselves by holding the sensation of I am here. So at this time, we're both Cal and myself are doing this exercise, and we want you to join us in this whole show to try and hold the thought, feeling, and sensation of I am here. Okay? So we'll be checking later. All right. This is the fact. Western psychology, without the smallest exception, has missed. Although many people came very near to it, they did not recognize the importance of this fact and did not realize that the state of man as he is can be changed. That the fact that man can remember himself if he tries for a long time. It is not a question of a day or a month. It is a very long study, and a study of how to remove obstacles, because we do not remember ourselves. We are not conscious of ourselves, owing to many wrong functions in our machine, And all these functions have to be corrected and be put right. When most of these functions are put right, and these periods of self-remembering will become longer and longer. And if they become sufficiently long, we shall acquire two new functions. With self-consciousness, which is the third state of consciousness, we acquire a new function called higher emotional. Although it is equally intellectual, because on this level there is no difference between intellectual and emotional, such as there is on the ordinary level. And when we come to the state of objective consciousness, we acquire another function called higher mental. Phenomena of what I call supernormal psychology belong to these two functions. And this is why, when I made those experiments 25 years ago, I came to the conclusion that experimental work is impossible, because it is not a question of experiment, but of changing one's state of consciousness. So today, with each of our shows, we are aiming to increase your knowledge about yourself and the world around you. When you are ready to begin to work to change your being and understanding, you will know and feel it, and you want to call or email us, because we can help you with that. Plato said that there are three classes of people: lovers of gain, lovers of honor, and lovers of wisdom. Where do you fall?
Now, you may have heard it said that there are two quite different kinds of influences acting in the world. And in the work, we refer to these simply as A and B influences. So A influences are such things as interest in business, making money, sports, science, politics, the stock market, all of these things that have to do with necessary or personal aspects to our lives: family, education, food, shelter, law, order. All these things are A influences, and they dictate what we do. And you only have to look at a newspaper or go on the internet to see how these A influences affect us and how they actually govern our lives to some extent. Now, there's nothing wrong with these A influences. They work on a person, and over time they develop a part of the person, which is the personality, and eventually the false personality as a person grows older. And eventually, from this false personality, other interests arise, which again are A influence, and which feed this cycle of A influences in humanity.
You can look at it this way. Pretty much each thing that we do, each way we spend our time, is a influence. Our entertainments, our distractions, our jobs, our hobbies, our families, our triumphs, and even our blunders. Pretty much each thing is a influence. Now, B influences are quite different. They do not arise from life and have nothing to do with politics, sports, business, and so on. Across the ages, we can find examples of the existence of B influences. We can see it in literature, certain religious ideas, and other types of teaching that have been preserved and passed down to us, often in disguised forms, such as allegories, fables, and fairy tales. In fact, it can be quite startling, after you start working on yourself and understanding these ideas, to be reading a book that was written hundreds, maybe even thousands of years ago, and find the same ideas expressed in the literature.
Now, what does this mean? To begin with, this system of work that we are studying is nothing new. It is a presentation in forms adapted to our times of something which has been known for the entire history of humanity. The ideas behind the work, though, have been adapted to suit our present times. There was something that was long ago understood and long ago practiced about man and his inner possibilities. So as we touched on in our earlier shows about esoteric school and escaping, are you caught in the matrix, these ideas have existed and been taught since the dawn of civilization. The teaching from these early years reaches us in the forms of legends and myths and allegories. The form has had to change, though, to keep up with civilization and to adapt to the general level of humanity at any given time, that is, the level of the people being taught, their depth of understanding, their preparation, their knowledge, and the level of being of humanity, their potentiality for understanding these ideas.
So all traces in history concerning the ideas that man is capable of reaching something of incalculable value, a treasure that cannot be estimated, through inner work on himself, constitute what we call bee influences. Since they do not relate to life, their existence in life is impossible to comprehend unless we understand that they are actually essential for humanity. So where did these bee influences come from? Well, as you learned about in our previous shows, men and women of higher degrees of inner development have existed and created esoteric schools for those who were interested in working on themselves. These evolved men and women constitute what we call in the work conscious humanity. That is, men and women who understand one another, who are not based on A influences. They've evolved beyond violence. Their knowledge is practical. That is, what they know, they will, and so do. Not only are they developed in the ordinary centers, but they have the power of being conscious to various degrees in both higher emotional and higher mental centers.
Now, it's from this conscious circle of humanity that the bee influences, which we talked about earlier, actually originates. They start out as C influence, that is conscious influence, but then they're sown into the general vortex of life, and they become bee influences. The reason that this happens is because C influences cannot exist in their actual form in life. The conscious influence cannot be understood by our ordinary logical mind. And so they end up being approximated to their original form, which is this B influence. C influence, however, can be kept alive and transmitted through schools which have a direct connection with people who have achieved that degree of inner work, of inner understanding, which is conscious humanity. In these schools, C influences exist and can be transmitted, but they're transmitted orally, that is, through direct instruction from somebody who understands to another person who is beginning to understand, and so on to a person who does not yet understand. So I'm going to read from the Fourth Way here, pages 83 and 84. Question. What is desire to awaken due to? Is it in essence? Angle. This is connected with magnetic center. Remember that in the first lecture, I spoke about magnetic center and the different influences under which man lives. This brings us to the question of why some people are interested in these ideas and others not. And what creates this idea to know, the energy to seek? Why people who live in similar conditions are so different? For one person is satisfied with ready-made theories and clichés, while another wants to find truth for himself. What is it that explains this difference in people in relation to new ideas? For some people meet with the possibility of acquiring new knowledge and so are not interested, while for others it may change the whole trend of their lives. People come to these and similar ideas in different ways. Some understand something. Others take them on an ordinary level. And the cause of this difference is that man lives in mechanical life under two kinds of influences. What does it mean? It is connected with the idea explained in the beginning, that man is a machine controlled by external influences, by things around him. He may be receptive to one kind of influences and not receptive to another kind. Most of these influences are created in life itself, by people like himself. But among them, mixed with them, there are other influences which are not created in life, but come from a different source, from people of a higher mind. They come in the form of religions, science, philosophical systems, esoteric doctrines, art, all sorts of teachings, and so on. They cannot be distinguished from influences of the first kind outwardly. So it depends on the man whether he discriminates between them or not. Man can live only under influences A, that is, influences of the first kind, and disregard influences B, not be interested in them. But if he is interested in these influences of the second kind and has absorbed them in sufficient quantity, a certain process takes place in him.
Results of these influences be the memory of them, collect separately in a special compartment and form what is called a magnetic center. Magnetic center is a combination of certain interests and emotional associations which make him turn in a definite direction. It is a certain cycle of ideas and a certain cycle of emotions. This is the origin of interest in this kind of ideas. Question: if we are mere machines, are we to conclude that you are trying to lead us, machines, in a certain desirable direction? Or are we capable of discriminating between truth and falsity? And if so, with what faculty? Answer: with magnetic center. Men are machines. There is no question about that. Only they are not quite the same machines as an engine or something of that kind. You have heard already that man can live in four states of consciousness, but that in ordinary life, he lives only in two. These two states of consciousness can be developed in man. These other two states of consciousness can be developed in man, but they cannot develop by themselves. They have to be developed through knowledge and effort. And the faculty that helps man to understand and discriminate is the magnetic center.
Here's a diagram showing the development of a magnetic center, which is the group of eyes that are interested in this work, and how the group of eyes develop into work eyes, which are in the four separate functions. These are eyes that can make an effort specifically related to the work. When work eyes and separate functions become united, the result is the formation of work personality. The work personality makes the false personality passive, allowing true personality, which is a complement to the essence, to manifest. True personality brings with it a more constant observing eye. With practice, growth of being, and observing eye, there may be divided attention. You can see this as a kind of being present more often and for longer periods of time. With further time and effort comes Deputy Steward, which knows all the eyes in the machine without being able to control them all. And finally, after long work and effort, comes Steward. Steward is the highest part of the machine and can control all eyes in the machine. At this point, a man is considered a man number four, with a permanent center of gravity in the King of Hearts, with permanent aim and valuation. This diagram shows the development and change of being that is possible in a person who begins to work on himself in an esoteric school, the first step toward real I. Our attitudes to both A and B influences shape and dictate the course of our lives. It is said that attitudes are acquired from outer influences of life, such as education, family, friends, country, religion, social position, and the prejudices which go with it, etc. A person may become his acquired attitudes by identifying. If you speak to the person in a way that goes against his fixed attitudes, he cannot hear you. If we keep this in mind, it explains a great deal about people as well as ourselves. An attitude is formed in the intellect from something that one has been told and that one has accepted. Then the attitude acts upon the emotional center. We may think from these undetected attitudes, and such attitudes govern the mind. Thus, a person is not free, but rather controlled by the fixed attitudes. These attitudes are like wires that connect us with events. When we have a particular attitude toward an event, certain currents produced by the nature of the attitude flow through the wires. The nature of the current determines the kind of influence we receive from the given event. We have attitudes to all sorts of things, and when such attitudes are undiscovered and unseen, they cause us misery and misunderstanding. This is the standard in life as we know it. At every moment we are taking some event, some situation in life, in a mechanical and typical way, chiefly through one of our attitudes. One way to look at attitudes is to see them as points of view that you always take mechanically. When you think of things which you take for granted, attitudes are at the top of the list. However, attitudes carry with them the peculiarity that initially you can only observe them by their results. Some people do not know that they have attitudes. Wrong attitudes affect each of us, since they relate to us as well as to others. There can be a very serious situation when a person has a bad attitude to his spouse, to his life, to the world, and to the people around him, and so on.
When we begin to observe our attitudes, we are practicing an important aspect of self-observation in this system. We need to know our negative attitudes. We usually take them as right. However, these attitudes are implanted in us by education and imitation. Negative attitudes make us empty. They do not think, and they work automatically. You can tell when a person is speaking from fixed attitudes. You become bored. You cannot speak with them. You can feel that they are thinking from their acquired attitudes and they are not going to budge. It is said that when you have many negative attitudes of which you are unaware and which you have accepted as actually being you, it is just as if you were wearing several overcoats all at the same time. And so it is impossible to speak to you about certain things. This can become quite obvious when speaking about several hot topics such as politics, religion, and sports. With wrong attitudes, which lead to negative emotions, we lose a great deal of our fine energy.
In the study of attitudes, it may be possible to change the way we look at things, the way we take things. And this does not refer to changing the situation, but rather changing the way that you take the situation. And if you can take this step, it means that you're not entirely identified, not entirely caught up in the way that you are. And you may be able to observe yourself somewhat uncritically. Then suddenly, if you do this long enough, there may be a liberation from the bondage that you feel. You may find yourself free of this wrong attitude and able to see it for the first time. If we had objective consciousness, we could see things the way they actually are. And we would have a right attitude towards everything. A wrong attitude gives wrong relation. With wrong attitudes, they lead to negative emotions, and we lose a great deal of energy. Now, we need this energy. It's the energy that we would use to build our higher being bodies, to build a soul. The question is how to stop harmful attitudes and emotions in ourselves. What we learn to do in the work, is to develop new attitudes and right points of view which specifically oppose the wrong attitudes which we want to stop.
Now, one of the techniques that we use starts with self-observation in order to see these wrong attitudes and how they lead to negative emotions and loss of energy. Remember, the system is based on verification, so there's exercises you actually have to do and verify for yourself. And with this verification, you can find that over 6 months of holding a right attitude in the intellect, you can overcome a negative attitude. And you're often, almost always connected with a negative emotion. So the right attitude becomes stronger than the emotion connected with the wrong attitude. When the negative emotion comes up again, the new right attitude has replaced the old, overrides the negative emotion, and you're able to react in a different way, rather than the same negative emotion based on a mechanical wrong attitude. One of the most common wrong attitudes is the belief that we can change other people. The right attitude, which is a fact, is that you can only change yourself. So in the work, we can only work on changing ourselves and not try to change other people.
Let me give you an example of how this process can work. So I know this person who had an attitude that it was useful to express his negative emotions and give people a piece of his mind, to tell people what he actually thought of them. And he realized that this was not a useful attitude to have. And so over time, he observed himself, and he saw this was wrong. And he saw that he lost his valuable energy in expressing negative emotions and giving people a piece of his mind. So he tried to hold a right attitude for 6 months, and this right attitude was something like, expressing negative emotions towards others is wasting the energy that I need to build a soul. And he tried to hold this attitude whenever the negativity or the wrong attitude would come up. He was able to build a permanent attitude in himself and overcome his tendency to give people a piece of his mind. Now, this is an oversimplification. We're oversimplifying these ideas in order to have them across. There are many other mechanical aspects that come into play. Features of false personality, identification, imagination, and many things in us that need to be worked on. But wrong attitudes are an important area of study. The important thing is to realize that with the study of yourself, with the increase of knowledge and being, we begin to have understanding of what is behind wrong attitudes and negative emotions.
So how are you doing? Are you still holding the thought, feeling, and sensation of I am here? Okay, well, keep holding on to it. So there are safeguards in this system where the student is actually guided through this process so that one mechanicality is not simply replaced by another. It is necessary to reflect on what influences and attitudes are governing your life in order to determine the change that needs to take place. Well, we've been using the intellect, the intellectual function, for most of today's show up to this point. So now we're going to show a video that expresses these ideas in a different function, the emotional function. What is the soul of a man?
Well, what somebody to tell me? Answer if you can. Won't somebody tell me that what is the soul of a man? I'm going to ask the question. Please answer if you can. Is anybody sure and can tell me that what is the soul of a man? Well, what somebody tell me? Answer if you can. I want somebody to tell me that what is the soul of a man. I traveled different countries. I've traveled in forest land. I found nobody could tell me just what about the soul of a man. When you want somebody, tell me. Answer if you can. I want somebody to tell me just what is the soul of a man. I saw a crowd stand talking. I just came up in time. Was teaching the lawyer, the doctor. Well, the man did nothing but his mind. Well, I want somebody to tell me. Answer if you can. I want somebody to tell me just what is the soul of a man. I want somebody to tell me. Answer if you can. I want somebody tell me, tell the world is the soul of a man. I read the Bible often, I try to read it right. And for as I could understand, nothing but a burning light. Gotta watch somebody tell me, answer if you can. I want somebody tell me. Tell what is the soul of a man. When Christ had entered the temple, the people all stood amazed. Was teaching the lawyers, doctors, how to raise a man from the grave. Well, I want somebody tell me. Answer if you can. Want somebody to tell me. Tell what is the soul of a man. Well, I want somebody to tell me. Answer if you can. I want somebody to tell me. Tell what is the soul of a man.
What is the soul? The principle is that from time to time, the minds which are able to see the future and know what humanity needs are able to sow seeds here and there. In the 12th century, the troubadours sang through Europe, and they were singing about courtly love. If we look at it historically, it looks as though conscious humanity were trying to raise the level of being a certain way, to put into men's hearts the love of something higher, beyond sex, something that would lead them to God. And the love that the troubadours sang of was a special kind of love, a kind of reverence. The point is to inspire people with the idea of loving something higher than themselves. We have an indescribable jewel in ourselves, our soul. The ruling faculty, one soul, has a great advantage that the many eyes can never begin to match. The many eyes are not real, and the ruling faculty is real. The soul has many names: one self, the master, real I, higher centers, higher mental centers, higher emotional center, God, the Son of Man, the Kingdom of Heaven, the Witness, the Third Eye, the Ruling Faculty. Ordinary man has not found a soul. It has to be created. In this system, man is divided into four parts: body, soul, essence, and personality. The soul is the life principle, a cloud of fine matters, or energies connected together and bound to a physical body. The Hermetic teaching is supposed to derive from the Egyptian. The Hermetic teaching, which was about 1500 BC, speaks of the Logos, and the feminine principle is spoken of as wisdom, Sophia. An important symbol in this teaching is the net. The soul is bound on earth by ropes and cords and pulleys and hooks. You can link with this the painting of man asleep. The cords are really there, holding the man who is asleep. This person is spoken of as being netted. Eventually, the person has to swallow the net, swallow all that binds him or her. In the Egyptian Book of the Dead, this mysterious net was supposed to exist in the underworld, and the deceased regarded it with horror and detestation. Every part of it, its poles and ropes and weights and small cords and hooks, had names which he was obliged to learn if he wished to escape from it and make use of it to catch food for himself instead of being caught by those who laid snares. He had to learn the names. Can you be freed until you see something and name it? The work is first naming one thing and then another, so that you acquire power over it. We see these small things one by one, the things that bind us. When the net is turned the other way, it can be used to catch food. That is why it is said that the disciples used the net to catch fish. This does not only mean swallowing the net, but transforming it, using it in order to grow. The raw manifestations which you have transformed give you power. The soul is not mortal. The soul has to transform the suffering of the physical body in order to come into being. This is an example of one of the laws we live under, the laws of necessity. Socrates says somewhere that man is glued to his senses and for this reason loses contact with himself. Man has lost his way. His soul has become immersed in outer things, in possessions and power. The soul must turn round to find its right direction and to restore to man the realities and meanings he has lost. The soul is an organ that relates man to influences at a higher level of intensity than the influences of the world. Socrates says, when the soul returning unto itself reflects, it goes straight to what is pure, everlasting, and immortal, and like unto itself, and being related to this cleaves unto it when the soul is alone and is not hindered. And then the soul rests from its mistakes and is like unto itself, even as the Eternal is with whom the soul is now in touch. The state of the soul is called wisdom. What binds you? All the requirements of false personality form a net that bind you. Attitudes, wrong psychic functions, negative emotions. A person working on themselves can find that they can transform these and swallow the net, and then they have more energy for awakening. From Socrates' point of view, injury to another results in injury to one's own soul. And the greatest form of injury is by making another person worse. As long as the soul is in the body is alive, and body and soul make one thing. When they separate, the body dies. Why does the soul go to the moon? The moon is hungry. At death, the soul goes to the moon, unless it is eaten by something higher. If man had a conscious soul, then death would have a different meaning for him. The soul is both matter and energy. Matter is not separate from energy. Where there is matter, there is energy. And where there is energy, there is matter. Being eaten by something lower or higher is a matter of conscious choice and conscious choosing. Where is the soul before birth? In a divine state of rest called limbo. From Socrates, if it is to these realities, beauty, goodness, and so on, that we refer all the objects of the visible world, recollecting our former knowledge of them, then must it not follow that our souls must exist before birth? Descending from a quite high level in the universe, the soul attached to a human form has the task to endure the pain and suffering on this lower level in search of the miraculous rebirth. From the point of view of the work, man is an experiment in self-development. He has capacities and abilities within him that he cannot access or develop without a conscious teaching. We must be taught to recognize and value the soul. The first step towards penetration of consciousness into the molecular world or world of relationships lies in the practice of divided attention. Self-remembering develops essence and feeds the embryo soul by the penetration of consciousness into the molecular world through divided attention. He learns how to simultaneously remember himself, the object on which he gazes, and remembering that he lives in the presence of something higher. A man's soul is the totality of the moments of self-consciousness during his life, or all the superfine energy which has flowed through his unused nervous system. In this way, a soul is born. With luck and in the right conditions, and many increasing recurrent moments of self-consciousness and their longer duration. He who has begun to be self-conscious has begun to grow a soul. Man has to become like the butterfly, a very fine spirit. Thus, of the many miracles on this earth, the greatest by far is the creation of one soul, as time will not deface it. Rumi said that whatever the soul in man and woman strives to do, the ear and the eye of the soul's king are at the window. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Where is your spiritual destiny?
We want someone to tell you, answer 'cause we can. I want somebody to tell you what about the soul of a man. I want to answer your question, it's big in many ways. It speaks of knowledge from above and takes fear from the grave. To know the soul's existence, it's learned through higher mind. With efforts and persistence, a man's no longer blind. Well, I want somebody to tell you, answer 'cause we can. I want somebody to tell you what about the soul of a man. All living things are born with souls, and then when they shall die, a reborn soul returns to God and drawn up to higher light. To partake in this mystery begins with divided mind. Many moments of self-consciousness leads to realms beyond our time. Well, I want somebody to tell you, answer 'cause we can. I want somebody to tell you what about the soul of a man. God, I want somebody to tell you, answer 'cause we can. I want somebody to tell you what about the soul of a man. Tell you what about the soul of a man. Tell you what about the soul of a man.
So how did you do? Were you able to hold the thought, feeling, and sensation through the whole show of I Am Here? I'm going to close with a quote from The Art of Living. No shame, no blame. If it is our feelings about things that torment us rather than the things themselves, it follows that blaming others is silly. Therefore, when we suffer setbacks, disturbances, or grief, let us never place the blame on others, but on our own attitudes. Small-minded people habitually reproach others for their own misfortunes. Average people reproach themselves. Those who are dedicated to a life of wisdom understand that the impulse to blame something or someone is foolishness, that there is nothing to be gained in blaming, whether it be of others or oneself. One of the signs of the dawning of moral progress is the gradual extinguishing of blame. We see the futility of finger pointing. The more we examine our attitudes and work on ourselves, the less we are apt to be swept away by stormy emotional reactions in which we seek easy explanations for unbidden events. Things simply are what they are. Other people think what they will think. It is of no concern to us. No shame, no blame. See you next week here on SBN.
Be sure to hop on over to the Spiritual Broadcast Network. It's the go-to place for all things spiritual. You'll discover internet television shows that you won't find anywhere else. You can also choose from hundreds of hours of spiritual documentaries and movies. You'll enjoy on-demand and live internet television programming 24/7. Best of all, we add new dramas, comedies, talk, and reality shows and more on a daily basis. So why spend countless hours searching the web when you can quickly find just what you want on the Spiritual Broadcast Network?